I haven't seen an Oscar bait movie this well executed since The King's Speech. And The King's Speech went on to get 12 Oscar nominations, winning 4, and wait until you hear the 4 that it won. Best Picture, Best Actor, Best Director, and Best Screenplay. Do you know how rare it is for a movie to win all of those? Usually the Academy is far more democratic and handing out the big awards. That's how you do Oscar bait. And I want to clarify that by calling these movies Oscar bait, I mean, sometimes, I'm saying it with respect, sometimes it's an emperor has no clothes situation, right? But in this case, these movies are actually quite good. And one of the things that they do best is that they're able to present themselves as important films quite effectively. But I think this is an even better movie than The King's Speech. And that's just one thing that it gets absolutely perfectly right. I had this later on in my notes, but I'll just say it now because this is, I feel this is the right time to say it. This is a movie that is perfectly executed in every single possible way, including presenting itself as an Oscar bait film. It's really amazing to behold. Now with The King's Speech, I didn't know that it was an Oscar bait film, that it was such a good one until 3/4 of the way into the movie. It's just a feeling you get. It just hits you. You're like, this is a film for the ages. But with Call Me By Your Name, I knew it as soon as the film started because the opening credit sequence is absolutely brilliant. The way the names are artistically scrawled over old photos and keepsakes not only perfectly sets the mood for the film, but it's visually striking and unique. Ironically, I couldn't find the credit for who made the credit sequence, but that person deserves a giant bonus check because they really do a lot for this film. Although I'm sure the director, Luca Gaudagnino, you know, weighed in on that as well. We're gonna get to him, but it's right from the get-go, you're like, oh, special Oscar-winning movie. Now let's address first the most burning questions about this film. Number one, is it a movie about a pedophile? I saw a couple people tweet me about this when I said I was going to see it. They were like, make sure you tell everyone it's a pedophile movie. And I was like, okay, let's see. And I'd say that while Timothee Chalamet is clearly way too young to be romantically involved with an adult, Armie Hammer's character is very careful in the movie. And the movie actually does a neat trick of flipping it for the second half of the movie. I don't want to give anything away, but it makes Armie Hammer seem like the more vulnerable of the two. You're like, oh, watch out, Armie Hammer, don't get hurt. So while probably anyone on the face of the earth would tell Armie Hammer's character not to pursue a romantic relationship with someone who obviously was still pubescent, it's presented very realistically here. And by that I mean very messy, right? And I think it seems more like just like a bad idea, which a lot of relationships seem like, to be honest, right? As opposed to seeming illegal, right? Like, I guess basically the question is, if you, while watching the movie, you're like, would I report this? No, I wouldn't report it. I'd maybe give some people a heads up or pull someone aside, but I wouldn't report it. I don't think it seems like that kind of situation. Number two, how graphic is this movie? It's super graphic. It's really graphic. Think of the craziest stuff you've seen on HBO. That's what it's like. But this is an Oscar movie, so it's tastefully done. And you really just have to decide where your own personal threshold is. To be honest with you, it was a bit much for me. But it's a really good movie, so I'm still glad that I saw it. But I just took a walk afterwards. You know, I saw the first showing of the day, and then I was meeting up with some friends afterwards, and I was like, I'm gonna go clear my head, right? Because you know what, like you show up and they're like, so what'd you do this morning? I watched some erotica, but it was awards potentially winning erotica, so there. That's kind of the situation that you find yourself in. Then three, is it really that good? You know, again, some of you are gonna be like, I think it's an Emperor Has No Clothes situation, Grace. There are a lot of no clothes scenes in this movie. But anyway, as for that, I would say, again, it's a complicated answer because I have to tell you, honestly, I did not enjoy watching a large part of the film because it's bad enough going through these like torturous roller coaster romances yourself, right? Why do you want to go through someone else's? You're like, I hate doing this myself. Why did I want to sit through yours? And I can't even try and make the outcome better in yours. I'm just stuck watching it. But that shows you how realistic the film is. I think that anyone, you know, no matter what your orientation is, can relate to to, you know, the torturous aspects of this movie. I mean, a big part of it is like, guys totally do that. And then also like, you know, I'm never doing that again, or I've certainly been there, but you know, this movie is a good reminder not to do this. So like, there was a lot of that while I was watching the film. And I do have to say though, that one thing that occurred to me after watching the movie that someone had to point out to me, you know, I was talking to someone about it and I was like, oh, this seems silly. Or, you know, I had like a couple of problems with it. And this person like just zeroed in on what the problem was. And that's that I think the movie, and this is its one flaw, and that's that it doesn't do a good enough job of reminding people of the time period that it takes place in. You know, it seems kind of modern, you know, Italy, who wouldn't fall in love in Northern Italy, right? I dare you not to fall in love in Northern Italy, especially these locations. But it has a timeless feel to it. So watching the movie, it's a little hard. You're like, why is everyone so secretive? Why can't you be together? I don't understand the stakes, you know, because, you know, we have such a society so evolved in these matters today that you forget that in 1983, it was just the beginning of the AIDS epidemic, that there was still huge discrimination in society. You couldn't be openly gay, particularly in America, where Armie Hammer's character spends most of his time. Timothee Chalamet's character is half American, but he pretty much lives in Italy all the time. So I think that and the book came out like in 2007 or something. So the book, that's a flaw of the book as well, I would say. So it would have been nice to have one, well, if you've read the book, you can tell us if, you know, they do a better job there. But I think the movie would have benefited. I mean, I wouldn't lose that opening credit sequence. So one or two scenes or some kind of setup just to remind audiences today how different it was just a few decades ago. All right, so the film, perfectly crafted top to bottom, and for just $3.5 million, no less. This is a great movie to see for aspiring filmmakers. I mean, this is the level of filmmaking that should be the foundation for all other levels of filmmaking. This is how you do it. And this is why movies like this win Oscars. So what are the standouts, right? Because again, everybody does a perfect job. Everyone does a great job. So I have to say the biggest standout is the director, Luca Gaudagnino from Italy, because as we've been saying recently, we've been talking about this in a couple of places on my channels, the director is the captain of the ship, and Luca Gaudagnino manages to have this film strike the right note every single second of screen time. He picked the right actors, he has the right locations, the right music, the right pacing, everything is perfect, everything, except for that one flaw, but it's amazing to behold. And so since he held that all together and he was the conductor or the captain of the ship, you got to give credit where credit is due. And also, it just seems so seamless, which is also really impressive. You know, not, it's not like one part of the group stands out. You're like, oh, well, you did a really good job. Too bad those other people dropped the ball while making this movie. You're like, it's just beautiful. I'm just watching it. It seems so real. But as for the actors, again, everyone's fabulous. And Timothee Chalamet does a very nice job as like the center of the film. I think he's pretty much the lead. But it's Armie Hammer's movie. And it's not like he breaks through to some new level of acting here. It's not like you're like, he's the new Daniel Day-Lewis. I mean, he's always been good. I've been an Armie Hammer fan since Reaper. I think he's very talented. But what happens here is that he is perfectly casted. I don't know if you've heard the saying, it's a popular saying, that 90% of directing is casting. And it's just like with Quentin Tarantino and Christoph Waltz in Inglourious Basterds. He was perfectly cast there, and Armie Hammer is perfectly cast here. And he also has such a wonderful role to play. The evolution of Oliver is just amazing to behold. From this mysterious sex symbol to this vulnerable, lonely man. It's just so cool. It's like you pull back the curtain and you reveal that this perfect specimen is an actual flawed individual. It was really cool to see. Still waters run deep in all that. And it's not just the work of Armie Hammer that accomplishes this. It's Armie Hammer. It's Luca Gaudagnino. It's the writing. It's the cinematography. It's the editing. Again, it's everything. And also, I have to say, I've never understood why he was cast in George Miller's Justice League as Batman. I was like, blonde Batman, get out of here with that. But seeing this movie, and again, how he was so mysterious, and he was like so standoffish, but yet really in control of the situation, it seemed, for a good part of the movie at least, that I was like, he could be Batman. I see it. I'm still not behind a blonde Batman. I'm like, you're going to have to dye your hair, Armie Hammer. But I saw him. I saw him in that as being able to handle that role quite well. So it doesn't get any better than this when it comes to filmmaking. Again, aside from that one flaw, but I don't think that's going to hold this movie back. They'll just talk about that a lot. Because once you realize it, you're like, oh, this movie's amazing. You know, it's like it really does. So I'm glad I could point it out to some of you here. I think it's going to go a long, long way towards making you realize how great this movie is. And it's an adaptation of a book, and it is like this romance and this torturous romance that takes place in like this isolated area. So I can understand the choice not to do it, but I think maybe it would have helped it with in terms of being more popular, maybe with the mainstream. We'll see how it's received box office wise. But methinks the Academy and other awards voters are gonna eat this up like a peach. I couldn't help myself. That scene, it's not as crazy. I mean, if you've heard about the peach scene about this movie, it's not as it's done surprisingly. It's erotic, but it has like a humorous twist to it that I thought made it quite endearing. That's not something you hear every day. That's some endearing erotica, boy. But they, you know, it's a credit to everybody involved. So that's my review of Call Me By Your Name. I'm curious to hear your thoughts about it down below. And as always, you can check out some more videos right now.